Está buena.
Hi, welcome to One People, One World. My name is Rabbi Yaakov David Cohen. I'm here with a very special guest, community activist Clark Peña. Shalom.
Shalom. Thank you for having me, sir.
Thank you for coming.
What a great honor.
Please tell us about yourself and about your work, please.
Well, my name is Clark Peña, and I'm a community activist. I've been community activist for approximately 20 years now. I started by getting involved with responding to shootings in the neighborhood, mobilizing community members, mobilizing clergy leaders to address the issues at hand at that time. Then we started getting calls from everywhere. And I got together with a couple other community activists, one of which is Tony Herbert. You met Bishop Rodriguez. He's one of the responders as well. And we started doing this to the point where everyone is calling because of the crime. And they call us, look, could you come here and see if you could create a sense of calm in the neighborhood? And that's how we started. I've been doing that ever since.
That's great. But I know my philosophy with this show is particularly, you know, it's titled One People, One World.
Beautiful.
Under One God.
Beautiful.
Under God. But my philosophy is that an ounce of prevention is better than a ton of cure. Let's give education. Let's give people focus on commonality, unity. Let's focus on education that doesn't come to any crimes.
Right.
And that's more powerful than trying to prevent crimes, is if we educate them, if people have a meaning in life.
Right.
And that's what it's about. This show is about bringing together people of all faiths, people of all race and religions and creed and economic backgrounds and so on.
Amen. Rabbi, we have been more reactive than proactive.
Well, the idea is if you're proactive, then you only need a little bit.
That's right.
Like if you watch your health, if you don't eat too much salt,
right.
You don't end up going to the doctor.
Right.
If you eat a lot of salt, just to give you an example,
correct.
You end up in the doctor's office.
Absolutely.
So the idea is to control what goes in, and therefore you won't have the problem.
Your proactivity.
Right.
And you have so many things that you have given me.
The good card.
That's proactive.
The good card is about giving people a sense of, hey, you're a good guy.
Absolutely.
You're a good woman. Here's a good card. And you put a smile on someone's
face.
And you show them that there's meaning in life.
Right. And you have it in Spanish. You
have it in all languages. We work in the United Nations.
So that's right.
In economic and social.
Absolutely. So it's such an honor.
So we actually deal with all cultures. And you know what? The interesting thing is, the more you see different cultures, the more you see how we're really one and the same.
Right.
Although we don't look alike, and God created everyone uniquely, distinctly, but our distinctions, we should celebrate our differences rather than trying to make everyone as one. For instance, men and women. Men and women are distinctly created different creatures, different beings. But men should be men, women should be women, and they should come together as one for greater unity, which is Hashem, God.
Hashem, and I know I'm on your program, and you're here to ask me questions.
Right. So let's talk about how.
But I want to ask you a question, real quick, and
sure,
I won't do
sure.
it again. Your philosophy. You're such a great human being, and you've been doing this for a while. You know, what is it that keeps you going? Because you must have down times as well, right?
The downtime is always to focus on the good, and always to study education. The more education is like fuel. Before someone runs a race, he has to drink a lot and have enough fuel in the body. Education, especially Torah education, it gives you a sense of directive. It gives you a sense of purpose, and that in turn gives you ability to focus on things and to be positive.
Always positive.
Yeah.
I've been working with a lot of other clergy leaders, and how do you recommend that other clergy leaders that I've been dealing with, how can they become part of a movement such as yours?
Well, the movement is really not, it's global, it's universal, meaning the movement is about taking a step back. Before, if you know a little narrative, before there was Abraham, there was Noah. first it was Adam, then Noah. Adam was the first the first creature, the first God created Adam, and then provided him with Eve and so on. Then they had 10 generations, which God wasn't happy with the way humans were behaving. So he sent Noah to try to get them to repent. They didn't. He started again by issuing a flood and wiped out everything. And these seven laws are basic laws by which God gave to Noah. First he gave to Adam, then he gave it to Noah again. That's why it's called the Noahide Code, or the laws of Noah, whichever way you pronounce it. Noahide, there's many different spellings and pronouncements, but it's basically the laws of Noah, which predate any religion, predate any organized religion, before there was, you know, there was Noah. And the first one is to believe in God.
Right, right.
So whether someone's a pastor or imam or a sheikh, whatever, or rabbi, believe in one God.
One God.
Right, right. Right. Believe in God. Obviously, do not worship idols. The idea that, you know, to accept God as the ultimate reality, the ultimate being, the Almighty, the ultimate truth, we should say, the ultimate truth, because there is no other truth, because God is infinite. He created space and time for us, for the world to exist, whereby everyone is finite. So he's the ultimate. He's above space, he's above time. He could be here, he could be in New Jersey, he could be anywhere at the same time. He's not limited by any one person or one place. He's above nature. We understand things from a finite point. If I'm in New York, I can't be in Washington. If I'm in Washington, I can't be in California. We see things, but God is above all.
So he has no borders.
No borders. He's beyond everything. So that's the first one, to believe in one God. So whether you're imam, whether it's Christianity, whether it's Judaism, whether it's, they could all adopt to this principle, believe in the laws of Noah, which are believe in one God, respect and praise God, meaning establish, do not blaspheme in his name, meaning do not curse God.
Right.
Cursing God, it's not going to solve your problem. The idea is to pray to God. And sometimes hardships are there only to make us stronger.
Correct.
The only hurdles for us to
overcome. It's a test.
It's a test, right. That's the second one. Third one is respect human life,
do not murder.
Which includes euthanasia and abortion. You're not allowed to just, you know, someone's old, I can't have this child, I don't have my second car, I might have an X amount in the bank account, too bad. Unless there's a serious, you know, life and death situation, abortion should not be taken lightly.
Okay.
It should be looked at only in extreme circumstances. Okay. And also killing someone, you shouldn't just say, oh, he's old, let's just pull the plug. Life is precious. If we can't proactively kill someone.
Right.
Euthanasia, do not murder. And murder is in the plain sense. You're not allowed to murder someone because you want his car.
Right.
Or you want his whatever. That's the third one. Then respect the family.
That's a very important one. They're all important, but that's really important.
Also that the nucleus of a healthy society is a normal family.
Right.
We're not going into what people do in their bedrooms, but if you want to call, I believe that marriage is between a man and a woman. The government should issue a license to marry, like it issues a license to drive a car. It doesn't tell you what kind of car to buy. It shouldn't redefine marriage. And if you know, it should issue a license to marry, because separation of church and state, and whether you get married in a mosque, a church, or a synagogue, or you don't get married at all, the rights should be the same in terms of taxes and all the issues.
You know, Rabbi, I was on a program yesterday on a different network, and we were talking about gang violence. I wish I would have had this. That is, I think, in my opinion, the respect of family, to have a stronger family, is the way you quell children from going into gangs and seeking that outside force. Do you agree?
100%, because if people have a healthy environment, they're able to grow healthily and look at the world healthy.
Right.
So it's just respect the family. You know, God created man can't have a child by herself, a woman can't have a child. The idea is to come together as one.
Correct, correct, correct.
To forge a unity for a greater being, which is Hashem, God, the Almighty. Beautiful. So in other words, men and women don't look alike. They, each one has their quirks or ways of doing things, right. But they're coming together for a greater purpose, which is to bring a child into the world, to be fruitful and multiply. Everyone should have a child and teach a child and respect, and children should respect their parents, and parents should respect the children. Should be a two-way street.
Absolutely, absolutely. And they should respect the elders?
That goes without saying.
Perfect.
Because you know what? White hair you can't buy. You know, you can't buy white hair.
Do you have that right?
No. Experience right. comes from white hairs, you know.
That's awesome.
You know, you can't buy it. You have to go through life.
That's
you know, the old
wisdom.
The wisdom is is going through life.
Right.
And being going through the hurdles, and when you're 60 or 50 or 20 or 30, a 20-year-old knows more than a 10-year-old. And a 50-year-old knows more than a 20-year-old, simply because he's been around longer.
Correct.
You know, a little kid gets, in 1 second, he gets all flustered and all, whereas you say, the idea is that you respecting elders is very important.
Very important.
Then respecting others' properties, do not steal. Everything comes from God. If God wanted you to have it, he would give it to you.
You would have it through God.
Right. Don't steal. Everything comes from God. You don't want someone to steal from you, don't steal.
Okay.
Then respect, then the creation of the law and order, pursue justice. There should be a pursuit of justice. If someone steals, someone commits murder or adultery, or, you know, there should be some sort of a form of accountability, not just, I could steal from the next guy, because then you need to have, people need to have the cops only there as a means of prevention.
Correct.
But as a deterrent. But really, education, like we were saying before, an ounce of prevention is better than a ton of cure.
Absolutely.
If we taught the children not to worry about the cops, but there's the eye that sees that's watching, there's the God that's watching.
That's true.
Then you wouldn't need so many cops.
That's true.
You know, we wouldn't have, if we knew, people would realize, you know, why should I kill? It's not, you know, God is watching. He said, how am I going to sleep? How am I going to wake up with myself the next day? How am I going to be able to? You should know. If more people in prison were taught the Bible in school, they wouldn't be in prison.
They wouldn't be in prison. That's correct.
And they're unfortunately victims of the system that teaches them run away from the cops, or you know, number one, Hollywood has to change its
right.
It has to do a lot with Hollywood also.
Right.
When I grew up, there were wholesome programs. Father Knows Best. Happy Days. There was rules.
Leave it to Beaver.
There was a sense of right and wrong.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Today everything goes and it makes no sense.
Absolutely, and it's really
damaging. You
know, it's damaging, and the proactivity piece really doesn't fall into place because there's so many negatives out there. So you have to find a balance here.
And it's also in your face today. Right. Today they have it on their phones. They have it, everything, from I don't want to go into all the, but
right.
really
all
everything,
the apps and everything,
or everything is in your face.
Yeah. Real quick, we were talking yesterday, and a father and son are in the same building, are in the same apartment, and they're texting each other. That's crazy. We used to talk to each other, right?
Right.
And that, we have to come back to that.
Right.
Have to come back to that. Communication, father, son, family.
Well, they have to... I think there should be one day, every family should try one day a week, no phones. No, you want to write something? Like take out a piece of paper.
Right,
here's a note.
Right.
You want to talk to someone? How are you?
Shalom. Right.
Have one day a week.
Right.
There's no emails, no phones.
Lock them up.
You know, no, just like
yes.
One day a week, like the old days, you know?
That's awesome.
You used to send a letter in the mail.
Yes.
You used to wait 2 weeks. Oh, they write it. Postcard.
Send me a postcard. I'll be waiting for it.
Right. And the final one is respect all creatures.
Respect all creatures. My favorite.
The idea that humans are God created humans the last, but he created all creatures before. So if we behave right, then we rule over the creatures. If we act worse than an animal, we mistreat an animal, then you could say, look, even an ant was created before you.
Right.
So the idea is that we are responsible to make sure all creatures are fed properly. You don't sit down, according to Jewish law, you're not allowed to sit down to eat before you feed your animal.
Wow, that's beautiful.
You're not allowed to be cruel. The actual one was do not tear the limb off of flesh of an animal. Today it doesn't apply so much, of course, there's refrigeration.
Mm-hmm.
But back in the olden days, they would, you know, take off a half a leg of an animal, and because they didn't have refrigeration, and then tomorrow, a week later, they take off another leg, and meanwhile, the animal would be going through terrible cruelty.
Pain.
The idea is that respecting that even the animals, they're God's creatures. They're created.
Absolutely.
They may not have the intellect, they may not have the same ability as the humans, but they're still created by God.
You know, what's really on that note there, in law enforcement, if you're responding to a animal abuse case and there's a child in that apartment, you also have to investigate. You have to look into that child because if you abuse an animal, you abuse a child.
Right.
So it's, and vice versa. It's incredible. This is very, very important. I'm an animal lover.
Okay. Well, listen, I personally grew up without dogs so much. But
you didn't have hogs. No, I always had a dog.
Well, I'll tell you, Brooklyn, when I grew up in Brooklyn, the dogs, they used to chase us.
Oh, really?
They used to be in packs of 10 and 20. I don't know, like today, we used to have...
You don't see them anymore. They're strays.
They were strays. Right. To them. And they didn't have to clean up after the dog in my days.
Really?
So
really?
The only time is when it snowed, you knew where not to step. Otherwise, it was a different city that we grew
this
up
is, in. This is awesome, Rabbi. Thank you for sharing this with me. I will put it in my wallet and always keep it with me.
But the idea is all clergy could learn from these laws.
Mm.
And they could come together as one.
Excellent, excellent.
You know, because at the end of the day, believing in God, respecting God, and not to kill, not to steal, not to commit adultery, respecting others' property,
right,
and respect the law, and respect the animals, is all what any religion teaches us.
Absolutely, it's a great way to start if you haven't been involved.
It's a way to say, you know, I think people could take a step back and say, well, I'm this religion, I'm that religion. I'm within each faith, you have different groups and different denominations and so on. Take a step back for a second and say, okay, listen, we're all human. We all come from Noah. This is like a way to say, before you, let's get back to basics. Yeah. And this is what the seven universe, this is a means by which society, all societies, any culture, any society could live in peace and harmony.
Absolutely. Well, this is my start today.
Well, listen, it's today also we have to teach, it's all about God is about love and it's about unity. Because God has many children. God created a collage of people. Dark people, white people, tall people, short people, fat people, smart people, more emotional people, intellectual, everyone is different. No one looks like, everyone is different. But the one thing that a father wants, he doesn't have children that are all the same.
Mm-hmm.
He could have a more intellectual child, he could have a more taller child, a shorter child. But one thing, when they all play together and they get on, that's when the father's happy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When we all get on, then God, Hashem, which is the Father in heaven, or Hashem, we call him the name, Almighty,
Hashem is
it means the name.
The name.
Because you're not allowed to pronounce his name in vain. Okay. Only when you're making a blessing or saying a prayer, you're allowed to use the name of God.
Okay, Hashem.
So you say the name. It means the name, or the Eibishter means the one above. However you pronounce it, it's just the idea that God is one. And we say, blessed be his name. And always, the other thing is also to think about gratitude. Yeah. There's always going to be someone who has an extra toy than you don't have. Whether it's the small toys or big toys. The idea is to be happy with what, and gratitude. Or, you know, you have the basic needs, be happy. Even if you don't have, you know, be happy with what you have.
If I may, there's something that I've noticed also, especially when we're doing community activist work, is that there's so many churches in our city. You know, it would be great if they would come out from those walls, because they're needed in the field. In the field, as you know, as you well know, you know, it would be great to bring them out. And you know, like your prior segment, I'm listening to you guys, and it's amazing the emphasis that you put on leadership. It's very important. You know, there has to be someone that takes the lead and motivate others, you know, in the name of peace.
But also, people themselves have to come together. It's about the people themselves today.
Individually take the responsibility.
Right. You don't have to wait to be, on the cover of Time magazine. Forget Time magazine. Right. Think in your neighbor, in your little influence, focus on that.
And expand from there. Yeah. Build the branches.
Right. Expand from there.
Well, this is great. I'm
glad. Let me hear about some of your work.
Well, you know, I've been doing a lot of union work lately. I just came back from Puerto Rico on a conference. And
which union?
I work, I consult the Law Enforcement Employees Benevolent Association, which represents DP police officers. It represents sanitation enforcement and DOT inspectors. I work very closely with a lot of other labor unions, to include the SBA, Pat Lynch and Ed Mullins. And I just had Ed Mullins on my program last week. And, you know, everyone is going through some difficult issues. And I think that, you know, if we follow this, I think we'll be okay. I'll be really honest with you, not because you're here. You know, this is something that I will definitely share with those folks that I come in contact with, because we're always thinking commonality, but there is a higher power. And I think that if we focus or refocus on this higher power, I think we all be okay. There's a lot of conflict out there, and it's a shame.
Right, it's a lot of diversity.
It's incredible. It's incredible.
I think if we focus on the commonality rather than, like I like to put it like this: before God created the world, it was just God. He had unity. He was just Him, infinite. There was no space and time. He had Hashem Echad. God was one. Yeah. He created a space and time, created a world of people, men, women, tall, short, all sorts of people. He created diversity. He wants, for God to have unity, He needs the diversity to come together as one. For us, for the diversity to have unity, we need the one God. So it's a mirror.
Right. I understand.
And we don't go into whether you pray to Allah, or you pray to JC, or you do. The idea is find the higher presence. There's an eye that sees, there's an ear that hears. And don't look at the differences. Well, he prays to this, and I pray to that, and he wears a hat like this, and I wear a hat like that.
Right.
Don't look at the differences, because you're going to...
And I thank you for inviting me to that conference. That was incredible. There was people, and we're gonna religious leaders from everywhere, and that was beautiful. I never think that can happen. I didn't personally think that can happen. But you had rabbis, you had imams.
Right. This is what I do in the UN.
Congratulations.
And I'd like to invite you in December to present you, with as an ambassador of peace.
Oh,
to show that this work should be spread.
Right.
You in turn will spread it to next person to next person, and it'll go on forever.
And I appreciate it, Rabbi, and I want to do more.
You know, because at the end of the day, when we inspire someone, we you don't know how many other people in the chain it's going to go on. Absolutely. Take it for example. Abraham was one man, or Noah was one. Let's take Noah. He was one man. He spent 120 years building a boat, which everyone thought it's not going to rain. It's beautiful. It's Central Park.
120 years.
It took him 120 years to build it. everyone was laughing at him, saying, "What do you, you go out and have a good time? You know, the bars are, the beer is cold. Every, you know, like, you know, go have. What are you wasting your time over here, banging away over there, building this boat?" The answer is one man saved the world. Each and every one of us could save the world. But we just have to bring things into perspective and realize that if God put you here, there's a mission. He has a greater mission for you, and he has a goal. As a famous line, God doesn't create junk. Right. You know, if you have this opportunity, you've been placed in a certain situation, then you have an ability to do something good.
Absolutely.
And then empower someone.
That's wonderful. Then and the event is coming up, and I plan to learn more.
Right. And the idea is an ounce of prevention is better than a ton of cure.
Absolutely.
If we could teach, get back to basics, then we've solved a lot of the problems that exist in the world.
Wow. And at this event, we'll, you know, and you've honored me with the card and this, will people be able to learn more?
They'll always. We always, besides this weekly TV show, we always have events whereby we're promoting peace, we're promoting unity. This TV show is about that. It's about a weekly show, it's about a weekly show that goes on. Been doing this for years and years.
Wow.
And, and we've been focusing on promoting like a lesson. I look at this like a lesson. You know, right, we have a lesson every week. Welcome to One People, One World. You know, that's
One
it.
People, One World. I hope that I can, if you will honor me and join me on my program, because...
Because at the end of the day, I would love to.
We have to let people know.
We have to share the spread the love.
Absolutely.
Spread the wealth.
And especially now that the holidays are coming.
We have Hanukkah. Hanukkah is a time we celebrate the victory over light, over darkness. We have a very few... We're able to be victorious over the many. They didn't have all the guns, they didn't have all the technology, but they had the message of peace and love and light. And light, you know, if someone says, well, darkness is so powerful and it has the media, it has this and it has that, and it has the answer is darkness doesn't need to be, is the absence of light. When you go into a completely dark room, it could be pitch black, and you only have one match, but that one match will light up the whole world.
I love that.
One match, the darkness can seem, wow, there's so much diversity, so much negativity, so much garbage, so to speak, on the internet and on this thing and on the TV and in the papers and every area, but one match. They're all gone.
You said it in the prior segment. Light a candle.
Light a candle. That's it. Light a candle, and that candle will in turn light another candle. And before you know it, we'll be in redemption. The ultimate of these seven laws is to bring about redemption. The ultimate redemption is when there's no more challenges. There's no more darkness.
Rabbi, you're amazing.
You know, right now, no, I'm not amazing. God is amazing. I'm just here as a messenger. I'm just a simple, humble messenger of God, promoting Hashem Echad, God is one. Whether you're Jewish, non-Jewish, whether you're short, tall, you're Christian, Muslim, I don't discriminate. We have the message universal. Whether you're Chinese, whether you're Afghanistan, whether you're American, doesn't matter. It's universal.
Wow.
It's truly universal.
Wow.
And the more you think about it, you realize that it's true.
It is.
I mean, is the blood in Syria different than the blood in Pakistan or again? I mean, yeah. It's all the same blood, the same.
Sometimes I feel it's us that makes it difficult.
It's people. People have to overcome their selfishness. Right. It's, you know, there's, I'll tell you a story, and you'd appreciate the story,
sure.
Working with unions, and I like to joke about it.
Yeah, sure.
There's once, in the UN, I work in the UN, yes. In Washington, I was just on Capitol Hill in the Russell Building, and last week I spoke in in I think Kennedy Caucus Room.
Congratulations, sir.
I always go there. I'm there every other. Anyway, so in Washington, in the halls of Congress, and in the halls of the UN, they were trying to put together a map of the world. And they couldn't do it. You know, they had Security Council meetings, and they had different committees, this committee in Washington. They couldn't figure out. They spent billions of dollars. This NGO was pushing this way and that way. And everyone was trying to, and this lobbying was lobbying like this. They couldn't figure out how to put together a map of the world where everyone's happy. Finally, a little kid comes. Be a 10-year-old boy, and within 5 minutes, puts together a map of the world. Every country is happy. The whole world. They say, "Excuse me, son, how did you do that? We're here in Washington. We had meetings. We've had this group, and everyone's happy. And in the UN, where we had this resolution, that resolution, this thing, this goal, that goal, couldn't figure it out. And here." In 3 seconds, you put together the map of the world. He says, very simple. On the flip side of the map of the world was a picture of a person. He put the two eyes together, the nose together, the mouth. When we get together, when we put ourselves together, the whole world falls into place. Uh-huh. So the idea is think global, but act local. Uh-huh. In other words, for us to put our eyes and to think that we could change the world, if you're going to try to change the world, you're not going to change it. Change yourself, and the world will automatically change itself.
So think global,
but act local.
Act local.
Think, don't try to change the world. Change yourself. Change your perspective on the world.
That's unbelievable.
It's easier said than done.
Absolutely.
Because this is, you got to wake up every day when people are in your face and it takes a lot of self-control. But the way to do it is to just focus on the positive. And if someone's going to be in your face, don't go that route.
Right,
take a different drive up. You have to go to 33rd and 3rd, go through 2nd and go around.
Try to
avoid.
Avoidance.
Avoidance. Don't look to try to... Because people could be rougher and tougher also.
Absolutely.
So try to avoid conflict. Just try to do the right thing, and try to avoid conflict.
And what I walk away today from, other than these great points, is think global,
act local,
act local,
and think that each one of us can make a difference.
That's right. That's right.
Each one of us has the ability to change the world for good.
It's up to us.
Right. Don't worry about the next guy. Worry about yourself.
Worry about yourself. Amazing. Amazing.
It's, it's about us making the difference and trying to change ourselves. And it's a lifelong task, believe me. Changing yourself, it takes a lot of effort.
But it can change the next person. It can change your community.
It'll change... It'll have a ripple effect.
Right.
Because, like they say, it begins with us.
Right.
And I think we're at the crossroads now where everything is in place for the good things to come out. For instance, internet, we're all globally connected.
Right.
So something positive. Imagine the internet is used only for good.
To imagine.
Only to spread love and peace and good news and good deeds.
Just like you guys are doing at the UN, more people have to know. More people have to know.
Well, my idea was, the idea is that I follow, the idea of Hashem. Mm-hmm. And any government is subject to peace and to answering for before God. Even we call God, it's interesting, we call him the King of Kings. Now we don't have the concept so much, but the idea of a king was that the king ruled. He ruled the country for decades, for years, for his sons ruled. The King of Kings means that even the king has to answer to someone. He's not above the law. The king can't just do whatever he wants. He has to answer before the King of Kings, which is God. So even the king is bound by the law.
Well, this has really been very enlightening to me. I'm so happy that we finally got together because we were always talking about getting together and your schedule and my schedule. Yeah. And
like I do, let's spread this peace and love.
Absolutely.
Because at the end of the day, we're all in this together.
Absolutely. And it's a great honor to be part
and
of
you
the
know
team.
What? You know what? I say I would like to bring up an example from Manhattan.
Sure.
Even though I don't like the overbuilding everywhere, but that's...
we were talking about that earlier.
When it came
it's too
out,
much.
I mean, it's... To me, it's no, but I'm just saying, but the fact that every country is in Manhattan, we're on an island, and we all know that green means go, stop means, red means stop, and we all live in the same island. If we could do it here in New York, we could do it anywhere.
We could do it anywhere. We could do it anywhere.
We may be a little obnoxious and, you know, a little honking the horns today, but overall.
In disregard.
Yeah, right. Overall, listen, I don't believe in this political, everything has to be politically correct, everyone's smiling at each other.
Right, right.
I mean, that's false, but real means we get along all together.
What's the saying, Rabbi? I prefer to be correct than to be politically correct. I just want to be correct.
Right, right. And correct before Hashem.
Amen.
Right.
Always.
Because he's the boss.
Absolutely.
He's the boss.
Absolutely.
I want to thank you for your time.
Oh, thank you for your time. And thank you for your gifts.
I really
do appreciate this.
I appreciate your time and effort.
Thank you.
To bring about peace.
Thank you.
And to help people in need.
And on my
work. And your work that, you know, law enforcement have to deal with.
Absolutely.
It's all a product of the fact that kids are not taught the proper education.
I'm going to try, if possible. I would love to give these to all the law enforcement officers that we represent, because if you go by this, everything's going to be okay.
And also in schools, the idea is there should be a moment of silence. Where the day begins, where the teacher, there's a separation of church and state, so they can't, they don't have to, the teacher's not allowed to tell the child what to think about,
right.
Only the parent. So a Jewish parent will tell him to think about Hashem, a Muslim parent will tell him to think about Imam, about Allah, and you know, how to pray to Allah, and a Christian, and so on.
Right.
And you begin the day with a moment of silence, where the day nothing is said, and the children have to think about there's a higher presence. It's not just to waste time, it's to begin to bring the children back to realize it's not just about marks and about being popular in the school. There's something greater than all of us.
Absolutely.
And this gives them, if they grow up with this, this gives them again the grounding that there's more to life than just...
That's their base.
Yeah, it's something. It's a base. There used to be more of this.
Yeah, I remember when I was growing up.
Yeah.
Well.
But the idea is...
This will be right here.
Right. And let's bring peace and love to everyone. And ultimately, we should all see the ultimate redemption, whereby the world, as we know it, the strife, this is all the evil trying to get its last laugh. Really, people are good. 99% of the people are normal. 99% of the people are good. You have a few crazies that are making a lot of noise.
Right, right.
But everyone is fine. The world is not... You could think in the media that the whole world is coming to... Basically, I have good news for you. The world is great.
And I think we're going to be okay.
We're going to ultimately see Hashem Echad. We're going to see the one and only redemption for all people.
What an honor.
Thank
what
you.
An honor,
God
sir.
Bless
thank you.
You
for having me.
Thank
God
you.
God bless you, sir.
Thank you. God, thank you for one people, one world. Thank you very much.